thanks for joining our show. I'm your host, Melissa Ridgen. Music makes the world go round, or at least it makes it go round to a better beat. From throat singers to powwow singing, some good old-fashioned niche country, or some hardcore fiddling. But there's a whole lot of other music, new music, that doesn't fit into a genre, and all of these things are kind of why Indigenous artists are taking the world by storm. Today, we're putting our music in focus. This is a booming industry right now, adding almost $78 million to Canada's economy in 2018. It supports more than 3,000 full-time positions across the country. Why is music so big right now? Why is our music so big right now? We're going to talk about that. And we've got some incredible performances from some brilliant Indigenous musicians that we're going to treat you all to. Of course, this is a call-in show, and you can phone and add your two cents, or you can ask questions of our guests, who include Alan Grey Eyes of the Sakihiwe Music Festival, and musicians B.B. Buckskin and Leonard Sumner. They're here to give us a show. You can call us toll-free at 1-877-647-2786. You can also tweet us at APTN InFocus. Before we get to our guests, let's take a look at the National Indigenous Music Impact Study commissioned by us here at APTN. Found some interesting statistics I want to share with you. Let's get started. So we've got Indigenous artists performed at on average at 23 live events or shows over the past 12 months the study was conducted. 35% of artists said that their fans are located within their province or territory. 21% said that their fans are across Canada, and 16% said that their fans are located around the globe. Now, how do Indigenous musicians promote themselves and their music? Well, 83% say it's through social media pages, their fan pages, while 42% have a website that's used to promote their music. And this is huge. So Indigenous artists have released a total of 50,500 albums and 22,500 songs not in an album. And for 98% of the albums, artists own and master the master rights and have not signed a record deal. To help us make sense of these numbers and more that's in that study, and the general state of the music in the Indigenous music industry, we're joined by Alan Grey Eyes, director of the Sakihiwe Music Festival. He's had an extensive career in the music biz and has served on the board of directors for the Polaris Music Prize, the Indigenous Music Advisory Committee for the National Music Center, the Indigenous Advisory Committee for the Winnipeg Folk Festival, and he's been on the Indigenous and Rap category screening committees for the Juno Awards. Thank you for taking the time to come
and chat with us
about this study. So some big numbers I want to start with, $78 million to the economy.
Yeah, that's a lot.
That's a lot.
Yeah, definitely. And I think like for Indigenous artists, they're experiencing a lot of great new things lately with the Channel 165 with Sirius XM. It's translating into...
What was that again?
Channel 165 at Sirius XM.
Okay, mark that down if you're curious and aren't
listen
on
to
Sirius
that.
Yet.
That's the Canadian Indigenous Peoples Channel, and that's translating into tens of thousands of dollars of royalties for Indigenous artists and rights holders across the country. So it's pretty incredible.
Yeah. So in terms of the study, was there? You've been in this business for a long time. Was there anything that surprised you in the study?
I think the total impact definitely is not something that we've ever seen before. So it was great to have those numbers. It was also great just to identify a lot of the things that we thought were happening, a lot of the systemic barriers that the artists and the industry was facing. And so, again, it's just great to have these first set of results that we can act on.
And what do you do with these results?
Take them to grant organizations, funding agencies, taking them to the CRTC, and just using them to advocate for even more change.
I love it. Okay, so over the course of your career, you have seen the industry grow to this. Like, I'm curious for you to track us back and kind of give us a little bit of a timeline of what you think were some of the things that led us to where we're at now.
Yeah, I guess I got started in the early 2000s and really saw like the emergence of A Tribe Called Red, really saw the strengthening and global domination of Tanya Tagak. And I think like the big difference between this generation of artists and the ones that came before us is, you know, they've had the ability to experiment and explore and innovate on the traditional songs, instrumentation, and vocal styles of our ancestors. Whereas, like, I feel generations in the past haven't had those same opportunities.
So it's just a matter of kind of getting those types of artists out there, and then once a broader audience hears of them, it just...
Yeah, that's kind of how it goes.
Mushrooms into...
Yeah. The good music matters the most. And so these folks, again, have the ability to experiment and innovate and create incredible stuff that has the foundation of those traditional pieces. And I think what they're also benefiting from is interest from the industry side of things. And so there's managers, record labels, publishers, publicists, entire teams that are willing to take their music up to that next level. And so it's a team effort. It seems like things can happen overnight, but really one release is probably 2 years in the works.
Well, and to that point too, you know, it's not just about the Indigenous musicians. Are we seeing, with this increase in interest in Indigenous music and artists, are we seeing that there's more Indigenous publicists, more Indigenous, like, is it just limited to the artists, or are we seeing it branch out into other elements of the music industry?
We're not really seeing that growth yet, but I think what this study will do is help us build a case to again, funding agencies and other industries associations. To invest more on the business side of the industry so that there's more administrators like myself, there's more managers, there's more agents coming from the Indigenous community. And I think that's super important because we have the same values as those artists oftentimes, a lot of shared experience. And I think like things are just easier when you know the length of that road that you both have had to travel up to that point. And so, yeah, I think coming from a common kind of perspective and standpoint and experience, I think just makes the path going forward that much easier.
And what exists now to kind of encourage that sort of growth? Are there programs? Are there mentorships? Is that happening, or is that kind of next to come?
I think there is. Like, I've definitely benefited from Manitoba Music and the Indigenous Music Development Program there. That's kind of where I learned all the business side and built a lot of the connections that are needed to have a career in the music industry. And so there's other, like here in Winnipeg, there's also an Indigenous Arts Administrator Mentorship Program. And so I think like, yeah, we're getting there. And I think like it was important for me to create space for new people to be in Manitoba music and to have those opportunities to learn. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think it's still the bigger push is on the horizon still.
Where are the places that are doing it? What other provinces? I know Manitoba is kind of a leader in this industry. Are there other provinces or territories that you're seeing this really kind of catching on?
Yeah, definitely. In Toronto and in Ontario, there's a lot more support through the Ontario Creates program. And so, like at Six Shooter Records, who is the management company and record label for Tanya Tagak and William Prince and Reet, yeah. I mean, they've got some Indigenous folks working there as well. And so I think... I think when the public sector support is there, like the grants and financial support, I think it just makes things that much easier. And I think there's also some movement in British Columbia as well.
Interesting. I want to say a shout out to Matt James, who won the Native American Music Awards Country Album of the Year. He's the only Canadian artist to win, so congrats to him. We would be remiss if we didn't mention that on a show about our music.
That's awesome.
I want to ask you, so you love music. Why aren't you a musician?
I'm better suited at typing. That's like I've got 10,000 hours. I believe in the idea of 10,000 hours to master your craft, and I've got 10,000 hours and more of typing experience, so that's where my strength is.
How did you get into this? Like, it doesn't seem like an industry that would be there's a natural path to, right? How did you do it?
Yeah, I just always wanted to work on the business side of the music industry. I think it's super fast paced. I like music. I grew up with hip hop culture and reading The Source and XXL and all these, influential or culturally influential mediums, and I wanted to participate in that. And I thought, like, representation is super important, and music gives us one of those platforms that we can use to challenge stereotypes about Indigenous people. Mm-hmm. And so every stage, every album, every social media tweet, every time we step to that microphone, we have the opportunity to show Canadians and the rest of the world that we're individuals and that our voices matter. We have just as many possibilities and futures as their loved ones do.
That's such a smart way to look at it, too. You have brought, because I had said to you, I want to know, I'm not the coolest person around, so I don't know who's hot right now, so I rely on people like yourself to fill us in, and I'm sure some of our audience probably feels the same way. You've got a couple artists that you could share with us, you're not ranking them, it's in no particular order, but who's hot in your mind right now?
Well, I'm going to refer to some of the most recent releases, and Reet. Like, she's electropop. She's kind of the next wave of the incredible stuff coming out of the Inuit community. And I think, like, stuff that she's doing. Again, she's a Six Shooter, same team as Tanya Tagak. And so she's kind of taken over the world now.
I love it. Let's take a look at Reet. That's a pretty amazing sound. And you, is she going to be at the music festival?
We had it this summer.
She was here already. Well, okay, who else do you have on your list? I'm trying to follow along here.
The next group is somebody I actually just started working with. I joined their team, I think, 4 weeks ago, ahead of the release of their latest album. They're called Nahewak, an incredible trio out of Edmonton. Like, these guys have so much depth and content to the lyrics and the songs and the process and the protocols they follow. And I just think, yeah, these guys are just great.
Let's take a listen. That is incredible as well, and new. Okay, we've got Kelly Cardinal.
Kaylee Cardinal. Yeah, she's another artist out of Edmonton.
What's with Alberta, hey?
Yeah, a lot of great stuff coming out of the Alberta, and they've got some great support from the Alberta Foundation for the Arts, Edmonton Arts Council, along with the Canada Council. And so, yeah, the arts are just really well supported out there.
Is it more from that part of Alberta as opposed to the south or to Calgary that you're seeing?
No, I think we're going to see a great example of excellence coming out of Calgary when we listen to BB Buckskin later.
Well, now you've ruined it. I'm just kidding.
Sorry about that.
Okay, let's take a listen to Kelly Cardinal. Looking back, I see my mistake. Well, I see every choice I made. Oh, you. Oh, you. And you know. And that's not a sound that we hear from a lot of our Indigenous musicians.
Yeah, she's got an incredible contra alto voice, I believe it's called, is what the classification is.
Say it again.
Contra alto. So Kaylee is, just an incredible voice. She's got a big tour coming up of Germany, actually, and then working on like more festivals in the summer of 2020 here in Canada. So a lot of stuff going on for her as well.
This global interest here, hey? Okay, who else is on your list here? We're checking them off.
Well, the next one is Sebastian Gaskin. He's a local kid. Like, he's incredible. This guy works all the time, too. Just great music.
He's, I think, in Europe right now, too, is he not?
No, I think he's still here in Canada somewhere. But he was overseas recently. He opened for Common earlier this summer.
Like, Common's a come
big,
on, right?
Yeah, Common's a big, I'm a big fan of Common. And, I was on a flight with this kid just from Toronto a couple of months ago, and he's still working on his laptop, composing songs and stuff like that. So he's working around the clock, and there's just some incredible stuff that's coming out of, he's going to be released into the public in the near future.
Okay, let's take a look and listen of Sebastian Gaskin.
I'm just dealing with some things for the pain.
Like, that'll melt. That'll melt.
He's a crooner, and I just love the kind of teardrop sound of the guitar too, and he's got that in a lot of his songs.
We have time for one more of your little hit list here.
So Iskwe, I think, again, she's coming out of Winnipeg. The other thing, like, I should know, like, I believe representation matters. I also believe that Canadians need to know that we all look differently. We're not all, like, like really dark with long braids and buckskin on. And so I think Iskwe is a great example of that. You know, she definitely looks a lot different, and it's important for Indigenous kids across the country to see that. It's also important for Canadians to know
It is true. For, you know, Indigenous kids, you kind of, you're treated differently if you don't look.
Yeah, exactly. And I think she's a strong voice for the kids that, you know, that look like her and have big, crazy hair.
Big, crazy hair.
Yeah,
I love
it. I got big, crazy hair, too, if it grows out. So, I mean, yeah.
We were treated to Iskwe, actually, APTN's 20th anniversary is this year. We had a celebration here in Winnipeg. Iskwe performed. So I'm excited to, when I saw her on your list.
Yeah.
Let's treat our viewers at home to some Iskwe.
The changing times.
That was Iskwe. Ellen, thank you for sharing some of your hot picks for us and for giving us an insight into what the Indigenous music industry is doing. That study was very interesting.
Definitely.
If you want to find more about that music study, APTN's Brittany Hobson is doing a story tonight on APTN National News, so you'll have to tune into that to get some more details what it all means. We need to take a quick break, but when we come back, we have Bebe Buckskin joining us in studio. She will be performing and chatting with us. You won't want to miss it. Stay with us.
When I try to scrub those old boards well, these tracks I can't move. Yeah. I fell down from my way. Yeah, yeah, yeah. My silver tapestry.
Join our conversation now. Call in toll-free at 1-877-647-2786. Like us on Facebook on our APTN News page. Follow or tweet us at APTN InFocus. Or send your thoughts to infocus@aptn.ca.
Welcome back. Bebe Buckskin, known to her family as Danielle Ashley Richard, was born and raised as an Indigenous cowgirl in the Great Muskeg of Northern Alberta. She's a gritty Cree Métis artist with a classic blues, swamp, rock, soul sound.
Yes.
There's a lot going on in there, in that mix.
Yes.
And a self-described, quote, ex-rodeo queen.
Well, I mean, not a rodeo queen per se, but so I never won that title, actually.
Were you doing rodeo?
Yes.
What were you doing?
So I was a barrel racer in my early teens, and then I had a baby and had to kind of give that up, and here I am. And
yeah,
I'm glad
pregnant
that happened.
Barrel racing is not a thing.
Well.
And I guess what is easier, to stay on a horse at that speed or to navigate the music industry?
Oh, they're both can be vicious beasts sometimes. But I'm definitely liking what I'm doing a lot more. I think this is my true path.
So were you always musical?
I was, yes. I grew up in a musical family. My grandpa, he played fiddle, plays fiddle. He's still around. Guitar. My mom, she toured all throughout Canada in a duo. She had like a gospel country thing going.
Love it.
And so I grew up just completely immersed in it.
And what made you say I'm pursuing this as a as a career, as a passion? What was the
switch
for you?
It hit me when I was actually 3 years old that this is what I want to do. Yeah, I remember being on stage for the first time and I sang a Patti Loveless song, and my mom just kind of threw me into the fire. She just like threw me up there, and I was like, okay, well, I'm doing this.
I think sometimes that's the best thing you can do as a mom.
Yeah, just throw your kids
just
into
go.
The fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
What did you have? I mean, you came from a musical family. Was there an Indigenous musical star that you looked up to growing up?
My mom.
Yeah?
My mom for sure. Buffy St. Marie is a big one too.
I suspected she'd be on the list.
Totally. And she's been such an inspiration to me over the years. And I feel like I was born in the wrong decade, you know? I feel
really?
Like my music is reflective of a lot of the 60s and 70s sounds. And that's where she got her start. So.
What do you think of the, we were just talking with Alan Gray, I was on here before mm-hmm. you were, we were talking about this Indigenous music impact study, mm-hmm. $78 million from Indigenous music into the Canadian economy. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think that anybody's surprised that it's a booming industry, certainly. You know, I'm curious from your perspective as a musician, mm-hmm. In the past 10 or 20 years, what have you kind of seen that's changed the landscape?
I think, well, Indigenous artists are definitely making themselves heard a lot more now than they were ever before, I think.
And
a lot of
it
has to do with like reclamation of our languages, you know, reclamation of our culture. We're taking it back and we're taking it by the, you know.
Yeah, yeah. You can say balls on TV.
Balls. Ball over you. I have a thing for saying balls on live radio and TV. Anyway, that's what I think, and I think it's awesome, and I'm so honored to be part of that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Well, you should be. And is mm-hmm. this, you know, is it us that's listening, that's consuming our music, or is mm-hmm. is it bigger than that?
I think it's both. I think one influences the other, and then it kind of makes a circle, you know, and it just keeps growing, getting bigger. I know a lot of my like non-Indigenous friends, I've turned them on to a lot of Indigenous artists that they listen to on repeat, you know,
yeah.
And it's just like this given, you know, this beautiful relationship that's formed.
What do you think the value is to that? Mm-hmm. Not just to the artists that they're listening to, but is there a mm-hmm. bigger, you know, social impact of that?
Oh yeah, I think people are just a lot more aware now of our issues and our struggles as Indigenous people. To have this kind of a platform is such a blessing, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm taking advantage of it totally, fully. I'm incorporating my own language into my songs now, which is
so cool.
Really, yeah. Awesome.
You, before we were on the show here, you treated us to a performance from one of your songs.
Mm-hmm.
I want to share that with our audience at home. Here's BB with Love Me Anyway.
Oh, to live like hippies did before the war, for the big ride. I just want you on my palate like acid. I want to taste the summer rain. Love me anyway. I'll do the same just love me anyway. Could live like beggar bones on the side of the road before it turns out cold. I just want you on my body like blankets, stars to be out with as well. Love me anyway, I'll do the same just love me anyway, yeah. I bet you got a girl, but she's her whole wide world still. Love me anyway, I'll do the same and I see you standing there, chapter in my story. Oh no, wish I could go back again. Could've lived like remember. Look, I'll do the same, do the same. I'll do the same, do the same. I'll do the same, yes, I'll do the same.
That kicks so much butt.
Thank you.
I was going to ask you another question, but I'm going to go now. We've got Tom from BC who's calling. He's a huge fan of yours, so I'll give him my time. Tom, thanks for calling.
Hello. Hi. This is the first time I'm watching this show, and that's very beautiful music, and I just wanted to say I really enjoy it.
Awesome. Thanks, Tom.
Where are you in BC, Tom?
Fort St. James.
You going up there anytime soon?
Where, sorry?
Fort St. James.
Okay, I'm not sure where that is exactly. I don't even know where that is, sorry.
Well, it's okay, because he can find you on Spotify. He can find you on bbbuckskin.com. Find you on iTunes.
Yes, my website is actually under construction right now, so won't be ready till about another week.
Okay.
But I'm on iTunes, Spotify, SoundCloud, all that stuff.
Love it. Mm-hmm. And what's next for you? Where are you going in the foreseeable future?
Well, I just released a single called Stock and Wood. That one is featuring Ellen McElwain. She's an amazing slide guitar player. Mm. So that's kind of been stewing around, and then I have an album coming out in January.
I love it. Mm-hmm. And before January, we have Christmas, and you have a Christmas song for us.
I do. Get us
in the spirit. We're almost into December.
Yes.
So this song is called
Christmas Must Be Tonight, and it was written by Robbie Robertson, the great Robbie Robertson. I love him so much, of the band.
I love it. And here's you playing it.
Come down to the manger, see the little stranger wrapped in swaddling clothes, a prince of peace. The wheels start turning, torches start burning, and the whole wise men journey from the east. And how a little baby boy bring the people so much joy, son of a carpenter. Mary carried the light. It must be Christmas, must be tonight. A shepherd on the hillside went over my flock out by. On a cold winter night, a band of angels sing. And it came to pass, he was born at last, right below the star that shines on high. And how a little baby boy bring the people so much joy, son of a carpenter. Mary carried the light. Christmas must be tonight. I saw it with my own eyes, written up in the skies. Why a simple herdsman such as I. Dream, I heard a voice say, fear not, come rejoice. It's the end of the beginning, praise the newborn king. And how a little baby boy bring the people so much joy, son of a carpenter. Mary carried the light. It must be Christmas, must be tonight. son of a carpenter. Mary carried the light. It must be Christmas, must be tonight. Must be tonight. Must be tonight. Must be tonight.
That was amazing. I'm happy that we got to share that with you all too, because we were certainly happy to hear that earlier. When you were in our studio. Mm-hmm. Now we have another caller who wants to talk to BB. Mike from Alberta, are you there?
Hi.
Hey, Mike, thanks for calling. You had a question for BB?
Yeah, I noticed you did the North Bloom Jamboree this year. I was wondering if you're doing it again next year.
Hi, Mike. Yeah, so the North Bloom Jamboree is a festival that I started last summer. And it was to benefit Palapuri Métis Settlement disaster relief. Mm-hmm. As a lot of people know, the wildfire, Northern Alberta wildfires, devastated my home community.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I put together a music festival called the North Plume Jamboree. And it was a three-day music festival on Sutina. And planning on doing it again, Mike. So hope you come out next year.
Mike, were you there?
Yeah.
Were you there before?
Hey?
Did you go this past year, and are you going to come to this one?
Oh, yeah. Oh, for sure. I was there.
I'm pretty sure this is my fiancé. This is my fiancé, Mike.
So he just wanted to get you on the record to pressure you into doing it.
Yeah, basically. Thanks, hon.
So, thank you, BB. This was amazing that you could take time to come here from Calgary to chat with us and share your music with us. It's such a gift, and it's nice to have it shared with our audience. You can find BB at her website.
BB. Can you shout out?
Yeah, go.
Sorry.
Go.
My school, my old school from Paddle Prairie, they're all watching right now, so I just wanted to give them a special shout out.
Paddle Prairie,
woohoo.
I love it.
Paddle Prairie strong.
That's awesome. And hello, Paddle Prairie. I hope you tune in every week, whether Phoebe's here or BB's here or not.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah,
they're like,
will.
No.
They will.
Your website's going to be up and running in a week or two.
Yeah.
Okay, that's bbbuckskin.com, or you can find her on iTunes, Spotify,
mm-hmm.
SoundCloud,
mm-hmm. all
that. All of the places.
All the streaming, wherever you purchase music online, that's where I'll be.
I love it. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's time for us to take another break, but don't go anywhere. We have Juno-nominated Leonard Sumner with us in studio. When we come back, you won't want to miss him either.
Gave this place the best of me, guess it wasn't good enough. Failure is a recipe, use the most when you're down on your luck. Made my way through broken dreams, lost family and friendships. Waded through dark memories, demons I contend with. I know I ain't no angel, but maybe I can save someone that's focused on the end of life. Down the barrel of a loaded gun, it's so hard to trust someone, you don't even trust yourself. So hard to love someone.
Welcome back. I am thankful to have our next guest here as a fan of many of the interviews that he's done in and around his 2019 Juno-nominated album, Standing in the Light. This Anishinaabe artist from Little Saskatchewan here in Manitoba has such an authentic soul, and it's really bared in his music. Welcome, Leonard Sumner.
Thank you for having me.
Is this your first time in our glorious studio here at APTN?
No, I've been here several times. I actually did an internship at the old building maybe 9 years ago.
Yeah. I would have just been starting here. I was over in the investigative unit, so we wouldn't have crossed paths. Mm-hmm. Were you downstairs in the studio?
I can't remember. It was 9 years ago. I barely remember what I did yesterday. So, yeah, it was a long time ago.
Well, I know several people who have interviewed you, and they say that you are one of the most authentic and soulful people that they've ever had the pleasure of talking to. Wow. And, I mean, that's...
It's a nice compliment, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I'm curious, when you, you know, was this something that you carried with you growing up? Do you feel like you observed things differently or felt things differently than other kids around you did?
I'm not sure. I've been told that I was a leader at a very early age. I've had a lot of people kind of tell me that, and that's kind of like how I've engaged with people for like for my life for the most part, is like recognizing that I do have leadership qualities and acting upon them, and you know, like just trying to set a good example for people, and also being like super young and being acutely aware of like racial tensions in the world, you know, from
really?
A child, from being a child. Yeah, I do remember stuff
how
like that.
How old do you remember being when you?
Oh, I remember being like 5 or 6 years old and understanding like that people had these different ideologies about what Native people were, and like, you know, like alcoholism, and still today that they're very prevalent, even though they're not very true.
Yeah,
people still stick to these old stereotypes about Indigenous people. I think they use that to justify, you know, the atrocities that have happened to our people over many years. So.
Right.
But it still gives me slight anxiety today. Like, I'm still acutely aware of, like, the racism and, like, you know, it many people have different experiences. And as, like, a large, like, brown Indigenous man, like, I have the brown experience
yeah.
of living in this world, not, like, some sort of lightly shaded existence. I have a very genuine experience to
For sure.
what it means to be an Anishinaabeg in this world.
And I mean, tell us a little bit about growing up in Little Saskatchewan and how that shaped the music that we hear from you.
Well, it's kind of like when I was starting to make music and starting to think about music as a path. Like, I listened to a lot of country music, so I was shaped in, you know, in the 80s and 90s, listening to a lot of country music. There used to be a station called KY58 that had oldies that my mom would listen to a lot, and so like definitely I've grown up listening to music and being surrounded by music, and like, you know, my mom was always singing, and you know,
I was gonna say musical family. There's
no actually I don't come from a very musical family, like,
but they're fans of music, I guess, so
absolutely
not,
yeah. Like, we're consumers of music for the most part in our family, but I have a couple cousins that like play guitar and stuff like that, but we weren't like the big, you know, fiddle family or anything like that. We were
yeah.
pretty quiet family, actually, just listened to music on the radio more than anything else.
I loved it. Mm. What inspired you to pick up an instrument or start writing songs?
To pick up an instrument was losing at talent shows. I used to enter talent contests in like Pegwis and like different places. I'd always lose to somebody playing guitar. And I was like, I'm not going to lose to them anymore. I'm going to learn how to play. And then once I learned how to play, it became more about the art. And then, you know, like now it's turned into a career that I've been able to, you know, manage for the past 6-7 years, you know.
And who taught you how to play guitar?
YouTube.
Really?
YouTube. I taught myself, and yeah, so I'm self-taught with a lot of my musical stuff.
Well, we are going to see you on the guitar here. You treated us to a song here in studio earlier before we got going with the show,
yeah.
And I want to share that with our audience. This is Leonard Sumner with Just Us.
Came in ropes, they came with guns, they came with words from God above. So it was done with righteous love. Never felt like love to me. Bit my tongue, taste the blood, got a feel of what's to come. Know your scales just weigh me down. I know justice ain't from this town. I know justice, she ain't from this town.
So tell me she's blind, I tell you that's a lie. The system isn't broken, it just works how it's designed. So tell me she's true, I say only for you. Cause I can't get away with the things that you can do. Look no further than the land that's beneath your feet, and how you legally possess it through violence and aggression. Control the narrative so your smiles become weapons, and the only stories heard are the lies and deception. When it's time to fill the ground, let's make her look me in the eye. So it was done with righteous love. Never felt like love to me. Never felt like love to me.
That is amazing. Where can people find your music if they're Christmas shopping?
You could find it on... Well, actually, like, I only sell CDs in person, so, like, I guess you could send
this,
me a message.
There needs to be more of that. I miss the CDs.
Yeah, and then, like, also, like, Spotify and Apple Music and all that kind of stuff. And then if you listen to Sirius XM, Channel 165, it's only on the online. But if you want to listen to Indigenous music, that's a good resource for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, Alan was saying that as well. If people wanted to get CDs, can they? Is there a website?
Yeah, or just send me a Facebook message.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I know I'm like very like, I realize my gift is not in business; it's more in music. So, like, you know, like sometimes it's, I'm like, yeah, I'll give you a CD, and like I often forget like I paid to have those made, and I probably should charge for them.
This is what makes you near and dear to a lot of people, though, is that spirit. You are expecting your first baby in the new year.
Yeah.
I'm very curious to see how that is going to affect or influence your music. What do you have in the shoot coming up?
I just recorded a new album in Montreal with David Hodges, who runs the Norwegian program. He actually produced some of my first rap music in 2000, I would say 2008, around there. Mm-hmm. So it's been a long time. We kind of went and had full-on careers and just came back into full circle and decided to work with each other for this new project. And I wrote a new album in the past couple months. I took the summer off. I lost my mom early in the spring, and it's dealing with grief. And taking some time away from traveling and playing music and stuff like that really let me recenter myself. And preparing for the new baby, you know, like, Creator never leaves an empty space, you know. So, like, we prayed for our baby, and we asked my mom, who's in the spirit world now, to send us when she had her time, you know. So now we're expecting in February. So it's very, you know, it's a very emotional time. And definitely it's been hard on her family, you know, so
yeah.
It'll be, to have that space filled with love again will be a beautiful thing.
I'm so happy for you.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm so happy for you. We have another song for you. I wanted to talk to you too about Standing in the Light. We're running out of time, and I don't want our audience to miss this song that you recorded. But Standing in the Light is something that if you haven't heard it, you need to. It's incredibly special. You had described it as kind of influenced by like your standard res mixtape. It's got a little bit of everything from Hank Williams to Tupac, and you hit so many genres.
So many different influences, like hip-hop and country music and rap music and spoken word and traditional elements in there as well. Everything that I've learned to allow to be a part of my life, you know, and then to incorporate it into the music, it all kind of came together on that album. It took about 5 years to write all the material and get everything together. And you know, people already, you know, they move on to the next thing right away, though. So,
yeah.
If you haven't listened to it, I would suggest go have a listen and, you know, check it out.
This didn't just come together. This was nominated for a Juno.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're going to go to another song. Here is, you performed for us earlier, Legacy. Take a listen.
Close my eyes to the light. I cried, I tried, be something I'm not. I lost myself in the waves of the way this beast would like for me to be. I haven't been home, but I've grown my roots outside the place that was my heart. I've seen the end and began to exist in a way. Carry on my love. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light. I think of you on sunny days and when I'm far away, and I've learned grief works in mysterious ways. Sometimes when close to home I feel the lonely in my bones, so I sit with the silence, disbelieving that you're gone. We lost the soul of the ship, a gift from the Creator, and though it pains us now, we know we get to see you later. We know you spend some time with our baby on the way. A little piece of heaven is reborn with you that day. I close my eyes to the light. I cried, I tried to be something I'm not. I lost myself in the waves of the way this beast would like for me to be. I haven't been home, but I've grown my roots outside place that was my heart. I've seen the end and began to exist in a way to carry on my love. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light. Oh, how you wish to see the places that your baby boy had seen. Send prayers to the other side. We know that they have been received. Your legacy upon this earth reach farther than you ever dreamed. Farther than you ever dreamed. And I closed my eyes to the light. I cried, I tried to be something I'm not. I lost myself in the waves of the way this beast would like for me to be. I haven't been home, but I've grown my roots outside of the place that was my heart. I've seen the end and began to exist in a way that'll carry on my love. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light to you. Carry this love in waves of light to you.
That's Leonard Sumner with his song Legacy. That's going to be on his new album, expected to come out probably fall.
Probably the fall, yeah. The album is called Thunderbird, and recorded in Montreal over a 5-day period this past month. And it's going back to more of my roots in hip hop, and that's like an acoustic version. I just thought it would be nice because my mom always used to love when I was on APTN and on TV. It's nice to pay tribute and pay homage to the person you love the most in this world.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And thank you for sharing that with us. That's incredible. That's all the time that we have for our show today. Unfortunately, I wish we could stay here and listen to our musicians for a lot longer. Thanks to Alan Grey Eyes, BB Buckskin, and Leonard Sumner for joining us today to share their insight and their musical talents. Thank you to our viewers, too. If you want to check out more of Leonard's music, you can find him on leonardsumner.com. You can find him on Spotify and iTunes. Before we go, we'd like to take a moment to honor Jerry Atwell, who passed away last week. He was a keyboardist for many different bands, including Eagle and Hawk
yeah,
and Indian City. Our condolences to his family. This episode will be available for a download as a podcast, aptnnews.ca. I'm Melissa Ridgen. Have a great afternoon. In this place, the best of me.